Welcome, everybody, to the Dr. Leadership Leadership Lounge, where we have conversations with business leaders from all walks of life about how and why they are successful. Hey, everybody, welcome to another edition of the Leadership Lounge. I'm juiced up today. I think, as everyone knows, I'm a pretty patriotic guy and love the USA chant anywhere I am that it comes out, sporting events, etc. And one of the things I really, really dig are the flyovers. And I'm really blessed today to have retired Lieutenant Colonel Russel Brown, call sign RC, we're going to get into that, former F-15E fighter pilot with over 650 hours of combat flying time. Got a number of great stories. I'm blessed to also work with Russel every single day. He's a senior manager of the customer experience centers and the media testing labs at my organization today, and a huge, huge asset for the team every single day. But want to welcome retired Lieutenant Colonel Russel Brown to the show. Russel, how are you?
Brent, thanks so much for the invite. This is a lot of fun. I've never actually done a podcast, so I'm pretty fired up to talk to your folks and talk with you. And yeah, thanks so much for the invite. I'm excited to get going today.
Well, it is going to be a great time. You know, I've known you for not a long period of time, but not a short period of time. And we were kind of banging around just some history for everyone's edification. And he said he was a former F-15E fighter pilot, first seater. It's a two-seat aircraft. He was front seat, which is the person in control of flying the aircraft, and then also the nose gunner. And then there's another weapon systems and navigation officer behind him. But I was like, you're kidding, right? I mean, you got to come on the podcast, because I love having military and patriotic people, and a fighter pilot is like numero uno for a desire for me to have on the show. So again, thanks for coming on. The pleasure is all mine. So lives down in Georgia, and a Clemson kid, but also a Citadel kid. But before we get into kind of the college and that part of your journey, tell us a little bit just about your upbringing. One of the really cool things here is I believe that Ike, Dwight D., the former president, yes, is a family member.
Yes. So General Eisenhower, former President Eisenhower, was mom's uncle. So I grew up knowing who he was. No one made a tremendous fuss about that, but I was pretty aware through mom about who he was, and so got a little bit of his history and all that stuff growing up. And fast forward to when I decided to join the Air Force,
not the Army,
family, and not the Army. I was like, I never saw myself as smart enough to be, you know, West Point Air Force Academy, Naval Academy type guy. And that entire side of the family got to West Point going back to when West Point, I think, was founded. So
holy cow.
I caught a lot of crap from the Eisenhower family for going Air Force.
Family reunions. You stayed on the other side of the picnic tables.
They didn't even, no hot dogs for Russel because he's in the Air Force. There was a good bunch of folks on that side of the family, and they were extraordinarily supportive once I got in. So it was all good and just all in good fun.
Well, that's a very patriotic family. And a lot of people don't know history. My background's military history. That was my degree was history with military focus, and World War II is very important. My dad was a World War II vet. People have heard me say that ad nauseum, but I'm very proud of it. Dwight was the man, you know, I mean, it didn't end without his leadership. And war's ugly, but he did the right things to get it done as quick as possible. And then became the president shortly after. So what a great story. And then who else?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, go ahead. No.
Oh, no, I was going to say, it's we talk about leadership a lot, you and I, and within the RICO framework. But Ike was that quintessential leader that just listened to everybody before making a decision. He kept his own counsel, but he included everybody. And I think we all know Montgomery, who was his
counterpart,
number two. Yep. And Montgomery was just a cast iron pain in the butt from, I think, what even the Brits had to say. But Ike was very much, I guess Marshall put him in that position because he was the guy that could handle all those personalities. And
right.
He's just a great leadership study because he was so involved with everybody on his staffs and making sure everybody had a say. And I always really appreciated that about him, because he had an enormously difficult job. I mean, that's obvious, but he handled it with a tremendous amount of grace.
I think
That's
a
hard.
key, and you hit a nail on the head here. First of all, Montgomery, for those of you that don't know, was the British commanding general, and when we built D-Day out, and Eisenhower, excuse me, Dwight was, yeah, Mr. President Eisenhower was responsible for all the Allied forces doing that when we stormed the beaches of Normandy and all around there. Montgomery was on his hip too, because there was a lot of Brits dying in the shallow waters right along Americans there. So that was a partnership for a long time. But where I'm going with this is leadership is more about listening than speaking. And it sounds like he was a really, really good listener to kind of soak it in. We don't have all the answers, right? No matter what you do in life, you got to be willing to open your ears a little bit and pull some counsel, as you said, from others. Because if you don't have all the information, you don't know if you're making a good decision or a bad decision. You may be passionate about something, but it could be, the exact wrong thing with a certain set of data points that you may or may not have.
Very accurate.
Awesome. Now, who else was? I think your dad. You had, a father that
Yeah.
was very inspiring to you too. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yes, I think, all of us as sons of fathers put dad up on a pedestal, and I was no different. But,
Yep.
dad for me, I'd be surprised if I come upon a mind as nimble and as powerful as his the rest of my life. He was a genius.
That's awesome.
Chemistry professor, and sort of a math savant too. I could tell you stories about him and some of the math professors at Clemson that just worked on some of the most ridiculous ciphers and codes for the NSA in the summer. That this was their summer job. They got paid a small amount of
Holy
money
cow.
to go up to Greenbelt, Maryland, and work on things with the NSA. I think he was the only non-math guy, but he was a good
That's
friend of his, Dr.
crazy.
Joel Brawley, who sort of headed this group, was a math guy at Clemson, and he and Dad did a lot of that for a lot of years. And so I'll tell you a funny story about Dad, and I told this one at his funeral not too long ago, and
Yeah, I am sorry
it
about the
brought a lot of
passing.
laughs.
Yeah, the passing of your father here
Thank you.
recently. That was
Thank
just a
you.
few
Yeah,
weeks ago. I'm sure. Sorry.
he was a he had a lot of good stories to tell, and what I re relayed to him and relayed to the group was I was struggling with calculus. I think it was 11th or 12th grade. I liked it. I like math. I like having a finite answer, but calculus can kick our butts if you let it. And
I
so
remember.
Dad was like, yeah, it's
It
hard to forget.
is
It's a
still
pretty rough.
nightmares.
Right. And it's flashbacks every once in a while. And so, dad had always been really helpful. He didn't push it. He was a teacher, but he wanted to see if I could work it out myself and then go to him where I got stuck. And so I finally got stuck on some stuff, and I said, hey, let's go to your lab. And this is back in the days, everyone 40 and younger has never seen a blackboard, but dad had this great lab where he had about four blackboards behind the place where he taught.
Yep.
And so we go in there, and he picks out a problem in the book, and he writes it on the board, and then he shuts the book and puts it on the table. And so I start dutifully, working through my steps. I think I used two full blackboards to show my work. And he's sitting there, and I get to the end, and I turn around, and he claps, he smiles, I'm beaming, he's beaming. I'm like, oh, I got it. And he goes, nice job working it out. You did a great job. And then it dawned on me that the book was on the table. He was not looking at the work shown in the book. He had done the problem
He
in
was
his
doing it right
head
behind you. Unbelievable.
while he wrote it on the board, and then he knew the answer. He could do math like that in his head. And
Wow.
I was just absolutely gobsmacked that someone could do calculus in their head. And that's what he did for fun. I play golf holes in my head when I'm bored or trying to
Yep.
clear my head. He did math in his head. So that was Dad. And he fast forward to the, hey, Dad, I want to be a pilot one day. He goes, I think probably in his head, he's like, well, that might be a little beyond you. But he never said that out loud. He said, you know what, you really need to be good at math and science, from what I understand from the
Yep.
guys that are flying. And he left it at that. And he said, however you want me to help you, I will help you. And he did. And so I think it surprised him a little bit when I got through all the stuff to get where I got. And But he was right there beside me the whole way, cheering for me. And he's the biggest influence I think I'll have, as a son and a father now. So yeah,
That's
but
awesome.
his math and science aptitude was off the charts, and that he certainly passed a lot of that on to me. I didn't grasp it like he did, but I knew it was important, so I worked hard at it. So.
So I enjoyed science, and I kind of peaked in math about 11th grade. I just, man, as soon as it was so many more letters than numbers, it just kind of threw me off. I am really, really good at base 10 math. My dad had a refrigeration company, so I can do, like lease rates in our business. I freak people out, because I can get to a pricing point and figure out what the overall total cost of operation is pretty quick in my head. But man, I peaked out early. But I had a great science teacher, and he was chemistry as well, and his name was Mr. Peterson, and he was so smart we called him Head Pete, as in HEAD. Head Pete, man. And I'll never forget, just sometimes, I'm not saying this about your father in any way, but sometimes scientists can be so smart
Oh, you're absolutely right.
that they're not like really, I don't want to say normal, but they just don't kind of fit the typical mold of people interaction. And Head Pete was
Very
that guy.
true.
And we were working on, objects in motion tend to go in a straight line when not impacted, right? Something that's going, he was taking a big steel ball that was on a pendulum wire or a string, and he was going to swing it at a blade that was on this holder. And he was going to show that that ball was going to fly across the room in a straight line once the gravitational force was gone, basically, is what he was showing us. And he swung that, he let go of that thing. He was up on a ladder and let go of this thing at 12 foot up in the air to get the momentum going. And it swung and it missed the blade on the way and hit the blade on the way back, and that thing flew off and went right through the glass panels of the door to the room in front of our
Holy
classroom.
cow.
And he's like,
No
"Oh
one
my
will
God.
ever forget that.
Oh my God."
No one
So
will ever forget that ball.
exactly, I
No shit.
remember that
Sure.
lesson because of that
Yes.
and his reaction. It was priceless. It was priceless. So
That's fantastic.
another thing we had talked about, and I bet when you said Star Wars, was impactful, and then the Thunderbirds too. But so was it all about the fighter spaceships there with Luke? Is that what kind of jazzed you toward
It
that
really
stuff?
was. So I'll age myself here. Star Wars showed up in summer of 77 when I was 7 years old. And I went because everyone else went.
Hey,
And I was just
I was
out.
nine. I was nine, so
Yeah.
it's okay.
That was my universe at that
Oh, it was
point.
awesome.
And I mean, the ships, I was fully convinced at age 7, by the time I was like 25,
That's what you'd be in.
I'd be flying somewhere in space. Yeah, that
Yeah.
was the goal at that point. I'm like, that's what I want to do. And that same summer, and I went back in and saw Star Wars like 15 more times. So I
Yep.
rode my bike down to the Astro Theater in Clemson
Yeah, for a
and did
buck,
that. But the
and you went.
Thunderbirds,
That's
yeah,
right.
exactly. It's, Mom, I'm going back and here's your money. The Thunderbirds came to the Air Force Base. It's an Air Reserve base now over in Greenville, South Carolina, called Donaldson Center. And this was back when they would park the jets. And at this time, they were flying the big F-4s, which is just a
The
big,
Phantoms.
mean,
Yeah.
angry,
Yep.
yeah, just
Yep.
a beautiful aircraft. And they would park them. And the guys would hop out and they'd come right over to the rope line, which was like 20 yards away, and sign autographs. And so I was right up there. Dad was like, yeah, he likes airplanes. So he took me over there and I was just absolutely hooked. It was loud. It smelled bad. It
Oh
was
yeah.
just,
The power
the
of it.
Phantom was,
Yep.
oh, it was just the greatest old school airplane ever. And so I was totally hooked that summer of 77. And I told a story one time. There was a, When the Star Wars movie sort of got relaunched, I was looking at something and my son Luke showed me this and he goes, they want you to tell your story about how Star Wars influenced you. And so I wrote the story that I just relayed and said, this is what I do now and this is why. I was going to be in an X-wing or something like that by the
Right.
time I was 25. And so wrote that, sent it off, never thought I'd hear anything about it. And actually got contacted by the guys at Lucasfilm and said, hey, we really appreciated your story. That's cool. Thanks for what you're doing.
That's
we wanted
awesome.
to send you something to say our thanks. And I was like, they said, what's your favorite part of Star Wars? And I said, and I kind
The
of
money.
in my reply. Yeah, no doubt. George Lucas's wallet, right?
Yeah, exactly.
He was a genius. He kept the rights to all the
all
toys
of it.
And stuff.
All of it. Yeah.
Genius. But I wrote back and I said, you know, I always thought the Millennium Falcon was cool because it was just this flying hunk of junk. But it was,
oh, yeah.
You couldn't tell it was fast, but it was kicking ass the entire time in the movie. And I said, you know, this was my favorite thing. I just always loved that's my favorite character. And they sent me a prop replica of the thing. I've got it here in my office. It's
that
like
is
2 feet
so
long.
Cool.
My wife hates it, but I'm like, you don't ever.
You don't ever
that,
touch
that. That
thing's
going to the grave with me. I'm like,
yeah.
That thing is,
bury me.
Like,
put the
know.
Flag on my chest.
Yeah.
And the Millennium
the Falcon,
Falcon down around my feet and
right.
Drape the coffin and away
that's
we go.
The way I'm going out of here.
Oh, that's
yeah.
awesome.
So, yeah, so, the summer of 77 was it.
So, let me ask you, your son's name is Luke.
Yeah.
Is that because of Skywalker?
No, it's not.
Okay.
His mom picked that, but yeah, he's a big fan too. He's been a Star Wars junkie since he was a kid. Now our 6-year-old, Anna Kate, has seen some of the other stories come along since then.
Yep.
So she's right around the corner in the kitchen watching the Young Jedi tales right now because she's sort of a guy. So my wife says she's just surrounded. I was like,
she has
yeah,
no hope.
Yeah,
well, it's funny now, you know, so I loved the first three, right? Empire Strikes Back, Return of the Jedi, all three of them. I mean, you know, movies were big. The theater was mm-hmm. an experience
oh, yeah.
when we were growing up,
yeah.
right? I mean, there weren't phones. There wasn't internet. You rode your bike right. down, like you said. You used to be able to go to a theater down by across the street from my dad's office, and it was a dollar, and you could watch all day.
Mm-hmm. Same thing in my place.
Yeah. Right? So you'd go in, you'd watch the same movie two or three times, and you'd go across the hall and mm-hmm. watch another one, new release. They had, you know, three theaters or whatever. But now you go back and you watch the original Star Wars, and it's like the special effects, you're just like, in comparison today with CGI and everything yes. that goes on, it is kind of funny to watch. But man, there were some great movies back. I remember Gray Lady Down, which was
mm-hmm.
the submarine
yeah,
one. And
yes.
I mean, man,
yes.
there were so many cool military movies back then. Midway, of course, was mm-hmm. huge. Talking about, you know, fighter pilots and that was a lot more dive bombers and torpedo planes and things like that. But man, just great, great stuff. Just gives me the chills to think about it. And then, you know, the Thunderbirds. So my brother-in-law went in right at the end of, but Air Guard reservist mm-hmm. and Des Moines, Iowa, they've changed it now. They're no longer, but we were, at one point it was the most combat experienced Air Guard unit in the country. And that was coming through, GW1 and, Gulf War One and that type of time frame. There was a lot of, mm-hmm. I think it was F-16s they had there maybe.
Yep. They did.
And, mm-hmm. But he was he worked on Phantoms and what were they F-100s? Is that right? No,
there was F-4 was the Phantom. The F-100 was the Saber or the Super Saber.
Super Saber, and I think he worked on both those. He was an engine mechanic, was what his.
Oh, he was busy on those. Yeah,
because it was a lot of work.
In it.
Yeah,
huge motor.
Yep, and so he did. I think 5 years of service that way through it, and he has some old pictures and things of that,
cool.
and just wonderful. So you geeked on Star Wars. You saw the Thunderbirds.
Oh, yeah.
You decided this is what you wanted to do. So how'd you get there? What was the story on getting there then?
I kept it in the back of my head. Dad's like, look, science and math, you know, whether you like it or not, you got to be good. So I just kind of plowed through those and found that I actually really like application-based science. When I hit physics, and I had a good teacher in high school that dad I had actually taught, weirdly enough, at college. So this guy, Dr. Welsh, was a physics guy, and he knew that
Head Pete was physics too. I think I said chemistry. Yeah. It was physics, not chemistry. Once you said that, I'm like, we weren't talking about gravity and chemistry. It was physics. He was Head Pete physics. Sorry. Didn't mean to interrupt you.
No, no worries.
Senior
no,
moment.
Good times. And yeah, so Dr. Welsh understood, at least he learned like I did, where he could look at a theorem and say, okay, I think I get that, but I need to have an application to apply that to. And he did a lot of application learning, on the side for me with things that were related to aerodynamics, and it made a lot more sense to me that way. And so Dad picked up on that. He's like, okay, you're a learner. You learn by doing
hands on
the same
ways. Yep.
Yeah. And it made more sense. So that was a big step. And as college was getting closer and closer, my sister and I were very lucky that Dad was in the position he was at Clemson, because at this point, he had moved on to the dean of the graduate school.
Wow.
At Clemson. And so he took us to a lot of universities, because he would go and recruit grad students, or he would go to conferences and that kind of stuff. And so he took us with him. And so I went down to the Citadel, which, you know, is only 4 hours away from where I grew up in Clemson. But I was aware of it, but hadn't really thought. I knew it was military school. And I was down there for a couple of days with Dad. And he had a good friend on the faculty there that showed me around, introduced me to some of the cadets and some of the leadership. And I was like, man, this is it. And
that's
so I didn't really tell Dad. I was thinking about it and we were riding home. And I was like, I think that's probably where I'm going to go to school. And he kind of snapped his head around driving the car. He goes, you think so? I was like, that was it. And the same kind of thing happened for my sister. She went to Miami of Ohio and met the chemistry faculty up there. And she said, this is it. So Dad had an enormous impact on
that's
showing
awesome.
Us different options. And the Citadel made a lot of sense to me, because I talked to the Air Force guys, pretty hard. Cause I was, again, had in my head, I was going to fly jets. The Army had helicopters. Those were cool, but I wanted to fly a jet. I didn't want to be in the Navy for some reason. I don't know why. It's just not flying off of a ship. So
not your gear.
The Air Force seemed like, it just seemed like, you know, the Air Force had the coolest jets, and I still stand by that, but a little biased.
That's okay. That's all good.
So yeah, that was, I applied. Dad's like, yeah, you know, get your application in, let's see what we can do. And so the Citadel, like I said, I was kind of a small time baseball player, and they had a pretty good program. And they said, yeah, you know, we'd like to let you play ball down here, and we're going to give you
that's awesome.
Good bit of money for an Air Force scholarship. So my dad was pretty pleased with that. I think one, because I got into college, and two, he was like, well, okay. He'd saved, I think, 4 years for each, my sister and I, to go to school.
Yep.
And both of us got full rides. And so
that's awesome.
I asked him one time when my sister got hers, I said, what are you going to do with that? He goes, oh, we're going to build a house on the lake.
Yeah, I bet. So he was.
He did. I was like, good for you, man. We all
won. God bless him.
So yeah. So
I had a niece that went to Miami of Ohio, too. Great university, in the Citadel, of course.
A great school.
I had my IT support person for years when I ran the Carolinas, had graduated from the Citadel, Mitch, Mitch Hedberg. And he was a great guy too. Mm-hmm. Still, I think he's still an employee with us, you know, 16,000 of us. It's hard to keep track of everybody, but, he always spoke very highly of the Citadel. I think my mom's 94th birthday was this weekend, and we were talking, I let him know that this was coming this weekend. I let my brother-in-law know that worked on the Phantoms, and he said, oh, I can't wait to hear it. And, we were talking about everything about the benefits of having a little bit of military experience. I myself didn't, so I'm not speaking from a position of knowledge here, but I was raised by World War II parents. So I was indoctrinated without having to go through basic, as I say.
You were trained well early.
Exactly, trained early. And I just think that a lot of societal problems would correct if we would give people focus on serving for something other than themselves for just a couple years. You know, a lot of these smaller countries do that. You know, Israel, whatever you think, positive, negative, for it, against it, they're occupying territory or they're rightful owners of it, not to get into that. There's so much story, you know, there's thousands of years of story there. But everybody serves. Same in Mexico. Everybody serves. Mm-hmm. Same in most Central American countries, all of the Middle Eastern countries. And there's a lot of respect and hierarchy of responsibility is taken very, very seriously. And I just think that's great that you
chose. I agree 100%.
Yeah,
I agree 100%. And being a part of something, and this is not something that would appeal maybe to a 22-year-old initially, but it does resonate as you get older, is that being a part of something that's bigger than yourself.
It's huge.
It's a nebulous concept at first, but then you're like, you know what? These guys and girls around me, they all have my back. I don't doubt that for a single second. I'm fighting for them. They're fighting for me. It's just great to have that sort of camaraderie. I mean, it really is. I can't tell you how many times I'm deployed to just some of the the weirdest places in the world, but it always ends up there's, I remember the funny, fun times, the good times with my friends.
You'll never
more
forget
so than
the experiences.
Yeah. I mean,
it's
fantastic. And so being a part of a team, you and I work on large teams at RICO, and you know, you can tell the people that have either learned how to do that or just have had something that sort of shaped the way they work on a team beforehand. And it's, you know, a lot of times it's prior service, or you've had a good team leader somewhere else in your background, and it makes for a better employee. That sounds kind of polarizing, but learning to work on a team as an athlete or service member, it really does shape how you function within that group. And it's usually, it makes you a more integral piece, I think. And
I talk so much about this on the weekly show, just about the village and community and mm-hmm. helping others. And it's not what you have, it's what you give. I got 1,000 of these analogies that I use and try to instill that in my children. My wife is very, very big on giving to others philanthropically, and it can be time, treasure, or talent. You don't have to give mm-hmm. money. You mm-hmm. can give your time. You can give your talent. The 3 T's of giving. And it is so rewarding. What the reason I do what I do, it isn't that I love the corporate stuff. You know, my favorite thing isn't getting on the phone with Asian influence and European influence at 6 in the morning and 7 at night, but it's the people. You know, it's Russell's, it's Rogers, it's all of the sales leaders, it's all of the support staff, it's the people that project management, our big deployments. That's what makes mm-hmm. me get up on Mondays, you know. And it really is true. Yeah, I've told a story in the past about how leadership is important too, having good leaders and I use the military a lot as a reference point. You know, in early Vietnam, there wasn't a lot of good field leaders at the platoon level or at the squad level. You know, there were unfortunately many American serialized bullets in the backs of platoon sergeants as Viet Cong or Vietnamese serial mm-hmm. numbers in the right. front, because they weren't developing the overhill mentality. And right. if you have good leadership and they know you're in it, I mean, you talk here, and we're going to get into, you know, Brigadier General Olds, and you say he led from the front. That's so critical. Mm-hmm. If you're surrounded by people that you know have your back, that you know are looking out for your best interest. I mean, you go and you watch these movies, and I'm going to Zero Dark 30. Where at the end, the mm-hmm. guy jumps on a grenade to save all the others. It's mind-blowing. And these are real stories. This happens every day. Mm-hmm. And the world is in a bad spot right now. It'll come around because evil runs out. You know, the fuse burns out on evil faster than the fuse burns out on good. But it's just, we're in a tough spot right now. So I went a little deep there. Sorry, but it's just really passionate.
No, that's
for
good.
Me.
No, you're 100% accurate. Yeah, it's... I think you have to, I should say you, I tried really hard to focus on finding the good no matter what's going on. Even in the midst of a crazy project, you know, one fell out of the sky on us Thursday at work. And after the shock wore off, everybody kind of just dug in and got to work. And I'm like, yeah, that's pretty gratifying. So my takeaway from that craziness was the team reacted beautifully.
Yep.
Despite a ridiculous ask.
Is this the PPLI? What is it, PPLI? Is that?
Yeah, this was the 7500 launch to go completely internal. And, you know, product launching is a 6-month process. And so
when you do it right.
Yeah, but
you're 6 weeks.
Right, I think, yeah, we have 6 weeks. Yeah, you know. So
I'm sorry, it wasn't me. Well, it was me when I lost my mind on the last launch and said, this SH, you know what, better get fixed. Yeah. So yep. I apologize
in
advance.
You were right to say it.
Yeah, I apologize.
Right that. No, that's good stuff. But yeah, I choose to try and find the positives. And, you know, there's way more good going in the world than there is bad. You have to be deliberate about looking for it. And I tell my kids that, I tell my wife that, because, you know, we can all get in our ruts of being down a little bit, and this is maybe it's part of the fighter pilot ethos or whatever. You just have to keep going.
That's right.
I would imagine if you talk to the guys in the infantry, they're the same way. The tankers are the same way. But those guys just keep on going. because going back is just not an option.
It's not an option.
You just keep working. And you know, the great line from The Martian with Matt Damon at the end of it, yep. He's talking to the NASA recruits and they're like, well, how did you survive? He goes, well, you fix the problem. Then you fix another one. Then you fix another one. If you fix enough problems, in his case, you got to go home from Mars. And sure, it's fiction, but that lesson right there was
resonates
just, I mean,
to everybody.
I stood up and almost applauded it when I saw it in the movie theater. I'm like, yes, that's it. That's it. You just keep working until the problems are gone.
Right.
And I love that. I told my kids that, and now when they see the movie on
like, oh, TV, God, here we gone, go.
Like, yeah, he's solving the problems again. I'm like, oh, I made my kids nerds like me.
Yeah, that's awesome. Well, so when people think they have it tough today, I think of my 94-year-old mother. So she was born in the Depression, challenging times. Mm-hmm. She then watched every 18-year-old, some 16, 15, and 14-year-olds mm-hmm. line yep. to go off to defend our country, and many of them didn't come home. Mm-hmm. She then got them home, and they turned around, and the younger kids and the families then headed off to Korea. And then shortly after that, the Cuban Missile Crisis and the Cold War started, and everyone was scared that they were going to die in a nuclear explosion. Then an assassination of a president. Then we move into Vietnam. Then Watergate. Then Iranian hostage situation. She says it best. Life is not for sissies. And it just, and when a 5 foot, she used to be 5'2", but she's 5 foot and she denies it every time. I'm 5'2". No, Mom, I'm looking at the tape. But 5'2", 100 and, you know, 8-pounder when she, you know, way back when she hates herself. You know, she complains about it all the time, 94, no metabolism. But when she looks up at me and says that, she's in charge. And mm-hmm. There was no option to that. Unquestionably. I didn't worry about my dad. I worried about my mom. I don't know if I can survive for the threat of wait till your father gets home was never said because I needed to survive the moment yeah. I'm facing
Same
with
for
mom
me.
Right
yep.
now.
Yep. Same for me.
She was fast and she had a big hairbrush. That's all I'm saying.
Oh yeah. That's a painful lesson.
Yeah, it is.
The hairbrush I know as well.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, so funny. So Citadel and then I think, and ROTC, if I remember right. Right.
Yeah. So I had maybe one of the most unusual, I don't know, maybe it's not unusual, it was to me. So yeah, when you sign the contract for the Air Force scholarship, you're essentially, well, you're not essentially, you are a reservist at that point. So I got paid a stipend to go to college, which at the time I thought was great. And but when Saddam decided to make a run on the oil fields
Kuwait,
to
yeah.
the south mm-hmm. in 1990, I was in summer baseball practice at the time in Charleston, and the call came and said, hey, you've been activated. I'm like,
what?
was that an option? And so they're like, yeah, pack for a 30-day deployment. You're probably going to go with my reserve unit. Was a group that we thought was going to Germany. Well, it did, but you know,
in route to
from yeah. Germany to Saudi Arabia, and then we went down to Oman and stayed there for a while, then went back into Saudi Arabia. So yeah, my junior year of college was done, well, 19 months really from, I think we left August 2nd of 90, went over and sat in the desert and then waited the go-no-go for mm-hmm. the air war. So yeah, that was
January of 91, wasn't it? January of 91?
Yeah, kicked off in January of 91.
Wow.
So we were, you know, there's some funny stories and some interesting stories that arose out of that, you know, not the least of which little Russell from Clemson's in the middle of the desert. Mom was freaking out and dad was like, man, I didn't know this is the way it was going to work.
I have a quick question. I don't mean to disrupt, but so do you just fly and air refuel all those planes to get them over there? Or do they ship transport them?
Yeah, you just pack up. Happily, the base that I was assigned to at that time, Seymour Johnson up near Raleigh, North Carolina.
Yep. Yep.
And the Air Force had come up with a great idea to call it was a mixed fleet there at the base. So we had four squadrons of F-15Es, two of which were training and two of which were operational. I was part of one of the operational squadrons. And the other side of the base had a whole big mess of KC-10 tankers. Mm-hmm. And so the tankers, basically, we would put all of our stuff in these giant shipping containers, like you see like at the FedEx terminal. They put all this stuff in there and put them in the bottom of the jet. The guys that work on the planes would jump on one of those and they would take off and they would get there first. Then all the F-15Es would take off with some other tankers, and the tankers would just drag everybody to wherever you were going. So they stopped in Germany. Some of them stopped in England.
Yep.
Gassed up again on the ground, got some food, and then flew on down to where we were going to go. In this case, it was Saudi Arabia and then Oman.
Gotcha.
There's a funny story when we actually landed in Oman, or excuse me, Saudi Arabia the first time. The first fighter wing from Langley Air Force Base up in Virginia, which flew the F-15C, they were the first ones that got the call. And so they got there. And so I think they had three squadrons. So, you know, 48 jets sitting there fully armed. And the Saudi base controller flipped out because, you know, he'd been told maybe a few hours before they got there that they were coming. But then we show up and we land and he's like, no, you can't stay here. We're too big of a target now. We're like, no one's coming at this place with all this.
Yeah, exactly right. This is the safest place on the planet.
But he didn't see it that way. So I was like, all right, yeah, tanks versus F-15s. We'll see how that works. But yeah, so we call, you know, Central Command and say, well, what do we do now? This guy does not want us unpacking anything. So we cranked back up and flew over into Oman and went to a place. It's just the middle of nowhere. It's just a runway, and unpacked there and built Tent City and did all that good stuff. But yeah, it was the wildest, most, disorganized is the wrong word. It was organized, but you know, only a few people knew what the real plan was. We were just kind of going where we were told to go. And so that was interesting. I'd never built a tent city before. And you know, that was fun to watch. If you ever don't believe that logistics isn't the most important thing in warfare, then you're just flat you're out screwed. Wrong.
And I think,
the
I
same
think
way Putin, in business.
I think Putin proved that point.
Yeah, he learned
in
that
the last
in the
18
way.
Months. Yeah. Yeah,
he has.
Yep.
So, but that was kind of fascinating to watch. And we had all these great civil engineers that showed up, and you know, driving a tent stake into sand doesn't work too well. So one of the civil engineering guys driving a giant Caterpillar loader was like, well, what we need to do is fly in some mud or some clay. We're like, where do you get clay? He goes, oh, I know how to handle it. This guy just decided to fix the problem. He was like a staff sergeant.
There
I think.
You go.
And so it makes a deal. His boss makes a deal with a Black Horse, the famous Black Horse guys and civil engineers call up somebody, and the C5 starts showing up with these pallets of clay. And they would lay one of those down. We would put a tent on top of it and drive the tent stakes into the clay. And, you know, and 3 hours later, it was a piece of concrete because it's 120
in the
desert.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah,
in the
so
winter.
Baked out.
In the winter.
I'm like, that's genius. But it would have never worked. I mean, we had these big 6-8-man tents that were just blowing down because you couldn't
hold anything. Yeah, that's right.
So it was a great example of just, yeah, I'll go fix that problem.
Ingenuity.
Just figured it out. So yeah, so, we saw some interesting stuff.
So I want to get into, you know, some of the stories and things, but the first thing let's talk about the F-15E. It's the Strike Eagle, right? Is that what it was?
Mm-hmm.
Just explain that aircraft in the Reader's Digest version. It's 2-seater. It's a multi-purpose aircraft, fighter, ground support, bomber, all the above. But just what is that thing able to do? What is it capable of doing just for the kids out there?
Oh, it is just the most beautiful flying machine that man has ever created.
I would agree.
I am so biased, but it is just the most fantastic jet in the world. So the E model grew out of a very, very successful older brother, the F-15C, which was designed in the late 70s to defeat the MiG-25, which was a super fast interceptor that the Russians were building. Turns out it was a hunk of junk, but we didn't know that at the time. So the F-15C, well, first it was the A model, then it was the C model. The C model was the height of killing machine technology from the 70s and the 80s. Massive radar to see things far, far away. Stable missile platform. Tremendous dogfighter to be a big fighter. It turns as well as the little fighters and just had unbelievable power. Still the only jet that can accelerate going
straight up.
So
more thrust away. Right.
Yeah. You point it up, put it in afterburner. It will, until it runs out of air, it's going to keep speeding up, which is a hard thing to imagine. But if you ever get to see one live climb out, it is a thing of beauty. So the E model came along in the mid 80s to have a deep strike, deep interdiction type aircraft that could fight its way in, drop an enormous amount of payload on a very specific tiny target, and then fight its way out. And it flew off. There was a fly off against an F-16 variant that just didn't have the legs, wasn't powerful enough with one engine, and a couple other planes that didn't make the cut. And so, yeah, it was successful from the word go. I mean, this thing was thought up in 85, I guess. Mm-hmm. And by 88, they were building them, won the contract. And obviously, like I just said, we took it to war just a couple years after that. And one of the other funny stories about that was, while we were in Oman, we were still getting black boxes, things that did interesting things.
Components. We'll just refer to those black boxes to protect those. Yes.
Yes. I mean, but there's some cool stuff. And the guys from Loral and Boeing and all the other defense contractors are bringing us this stuff. And we're like, man, that's really cool. Wait, you want us to put it in?
Yeah, we haven't tested this stuff. Why are you handing me the toolbox?
Right. So we learned how to put all this stuff in while we were over there. And that was actually kind of fun. But, you know, it worked beautifully. That was the gratifying thing was, you know, the stuff came off the engineering test stands, went into the jet, and almost all the time it worked really, really well.
That's just
so
amazing.
It was a fun jet. Like I said, it was purpose built to be, you know, and you mentioned it, it's a two seater. So the F-15C is a single seater. Its job is to shoot down other airplanes. This, the E model, had that same capability to shoot down other airplanes, but also carry an enormous amount of bombs to a target. And it had an interesting capability to fly at night, very low, very fast. Its ancestor was the F-111, the Aardvark, which mm-hmm. was also just a really badass jet that they could fly really low, really fast. And so a lot of that terrain following at night capability, it was slung underneath the F-111 in this giant canoe-shaped pod, weighed a ton. And by the time the E model F-15 came along, it was housed in two small pods that sit underneath the engine intakes. So you could set the thing at whatever altitude you wanted, whatever terrain was ahead, it would fly up and over it and keep you at whatever altitude setting you put it on. So if you say 200 feet at night, and believe me, this gets your attention the first time you're training on the airplane to do this. So, hey, there's a hill coming up. And the plane's like, yeah, whatever, and just flies over the top of it. And
how fast? How fast are you doing this type of stuff?
You can get the E model up at 200 feet. Obviously, it's hard to be
right. That's right. You can't go full knot. Yeah,
yeah. I mean, its top speed is well over two times the speed of sound. Down low like that, if you're going 500-600 knots, which is easy to do,
yep.
You're getting there. You know, really just about the fast. Same time the sound does, so no one knows you're coming, especially at 200 feet, and then you're gone because it's, you know, the thing's moving so fast when it goes over your head. So it is an impressive thing to see the jet do that, and that's just what it does. I mean, it's designed to fight at night. It's darker gray than the other F-15s yep. because it's flying at night most of the time, and it is just a badass jet. I love it dearly.
Now you were a nose gunner.
I still love it.
Oh, I bet you do. Nose gunner. What was that? 20mm cannon. What was on the front of that thing?
Well, that's our the Wizzo Union. The guys in the back seat. You know, we call them the weenies in the back. But you know, the crew coordination is fantastic. They call us nose gunners. We call them, you know, the guy, the GIB, the guy in the back.
GIB. That's hysterical.
It's all in good fun. I mean, the coordination is what makes that jet so fantastic. I mean, if you've ever watched, good example of it's, you know, the recent Maverick movie where they had the two seat 18s versus the one seater, and the two seaters, you know, it's just a more survivable configuration because one guy has an awful lot to deal with.
Yeah. You got four eyes on it and two brains working.
So
that's right.
It's just better to work that way. And so the E model was really the first fighter that, you know, the F-14 came along very similarly, and the Navy figured it out about the same time as the 15C that two guys working the problem was better than one. So.
Yep. Unbelievable. So I want to move into this next section. We kind of preemptively talked about. So I introduced you as retired Lieutenant Colonel RC Brown, Russel Brown.
Yeah.
Let's talk about call signs here for a minute, because I think there's probably some pretty good stories here. You've told me what yours stood for, which I chuckled at, but you had a couple others you wanted to review with us. I just think are hilarious. So
yeah, they're fun stories. So a little background for those that wonder about funny call signs. So there's always a guy, at least in the Air Force. I don't know how it works in the other branches, like in the Navy, but there's a senior major in every squadron. He's called the mayor. So there's a lieutenant colonel who's the boss. He's the squadron commander. He has an XO who's also easily a major that's about to become a lieutenant colonel, and he's the XO. So those guys are the business leaders. They make all the decisions. They fly occasionally. The mayor flies pretty much every day. He's the senior guy. He shows everyone how to conduct themselves appropriately. So he knows everyone very well. And the mayor, usually when new guys show up, he watches them very closely. And if things are said, or if, you know, weaknesses are observed, whatever, the mayor is on top of it. So he knows you pretty well. And he's there as kind of like the favorite uncle. And he's always got his arm around you, like you should have done it this way. And so it's a fantastic guy to have in the squadron. But the mayor usually comes up with your call sign after observing you for a while. And so when I showed up, I got there with, I think, four other guys. And the story I got afterwards, I think we got our name not too long after that, a few months. And he drops RC on me, RC. And I'm like, new initials, I'm RB, Russel Brown, now I'm RC. And he goes, no, nothing like that. He goes, you're the biggest nerd we know. I'm like, what do you mean? How am I a nerd, and how does RC correlate to nerd? He goes, so, and this is what it is, 1993.
Oh, three.
This is when I came back in after going to college. So the mayor looks at me, and he goes, well, and for those of you that are younger than, say, 45, you may not remember Richie Cunningham from Happy Days, but Richie was Ron Howard. Ron Howard played him beautifully. He just, he kissed mom every day before he left. He called mom, went to church, tried to go about it most of the time the right way. And so I became Richie Cunningham because they caught me calling mom from the squadron bar phone one day. I'm like, man, you're a nerd. And so it stuck. I was RC, and it was a nice, short, easy to say nickname. So.
Yep.
But that one, I'm like, okay, that could have been worse.
Yeah,
some of them are really bad. Some of them are really, really off color. My good buddy Kevin Reardon is a pilot for Delta these days, and he flew the E model for a lot of years. He was Stump, and Stump came about because he went to Purdue, excellent engineering school.
Yeah.
But all he talked about was how great Notre Dame was. And he was the biggest Irish fan in the world. I'm like, you know what? The Subway alumni, I get it. There are a lot of folks that are Catholic that love Notre Dame in the Midwest. He was one of those guys.
Yep.
And he got stumped because the mayor said, well, if you weren't dumb as a stump, you could have gotten into Notre Dame. So you're now stumped.
Dumb as a stump.
And I'm like, man, that's kind of a pejorative for Purdue, because that school's pretty good at engineering. But yeah, that's just how it works. And I kind of think that the mayor may not have been a Notre Dame fan.
And I don't want to derail you, but real quick Notre Dame story. So when I was growing up in the 70s, Sunday morning TV consisted of two things in Des Moines, Iowa: the replay of the Notre Dame game from the day before, or the locals versus the out-of-towners bowling league
yes.
on TV.
Yes.
So you were forced to watch Notre Dame play football. And my dad complained about it every Saturday as we'd watch the first half of the Notre Dame game, and then we'd switched over to Jim Zobel, who was the voice of the Hawkeyes, Iowa Hawkeyes, for 60 years. And
fighting Niall Kinnicks.
Yeah, that's right. And he would announce the locals versus the out of towners this week are the Mason City Maniacs with a bowling average of 228 yes. across the team. Just hysterical to look back, we have no concept. So Stump, that's awesome. What else you got?
Yeah, there was one, and this guy just retired, Daryl Roberson, retired as Vice Chief of the Air Force, 4-star.
Wow.
Very proud to know OBD. And he got OBD early. He was, let's see, when I showed up, OBD was already, I think he was a major. So he had a meteoric career. I mean, he was just a man. He was a Thunderbird pilot. He did it all. I mean, that's how you get to
that's awesome.
OBD, I asked him one day, I'm like, how'd you get your nickname? And I said, I don't know, OBD. He goes, you remember that? Again, you got to be 45 or older. The Bob Newhart show, which was a comedy show back in the 80s. So when
talking when he was the OBD, psychiatrist, that one? Or,
exactly.
Okay, yep.
So Bob Newhart had two guys that like watched after his house on the show. And one was Daryl and the other was his other brother, Daryl. Daryl and his other brother, Daryl. So,
oh, so this is when he owned the inn up in Maine or whatever, not when he was the psychiatrist show, because Newhart had a show before that show. That's right. That's right. You aren't old enough maybe for that one.
I remember that very, when I was a kid, I guess.
Yep. So you're talking Daryl and other brother, Daryl, hysterical.
Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, there was already a Daryl there. So when he got there, he became OBD because there was, you can't have two Daryls. So the mayor made the perfect choice to give him OBD. So that was one of my favorites. The quickest nickname I ever saw was Mark Tipmongle showed up from the academy, rolled in, smart guy, really a lot of fun to work with. But if you've ever seen the Disney animated movie, The Jungle Book, so the kid that's stuck in the jungle with the bear and the tiger was named Mowgli.
Yep.
And Mark walked in and had on a t-shirt and a pair of shorts and a pair of flip-flops. And the mayor just stood up and screamed out, Mowgli, you're Mowgli. And he's like, what?
Done.
So that his nickname happened like within 3 seconds of him rocking in the bar. So that was the fastest one I ever heard. Another good buddy named Pete Sipperly, who Pete was the calmest guy. I mean, there could be mass hysteria within 5 feet of Pete, and he would just sit there and quietly drink his beer. And so he very quickly became Pulse for lack of a pulse. Pulse Sipperly, because he was just unbelievably calm in all situations.
These are so awesome.
And the last one I'll share was my first squadron commander was just a fantastic guy. Denny was an amazing pilot, great manager, just no nonsense, kind of in the Robin Olds, I guess, the way he conducted himself. He was very similar to General Olds. But his nickname, and this obviously happened long before I got there, he had the name Dirtbag for a lot of years. And so one day I said, boss, why do they call you Dirtbag? And he goes, I think it was Cal State Santa Barbara, or one of the Cal State schools is named the Dirtbags.
You're
and
kidding.
He had played baseball. Yeah. And so he was, I should have looked this up. I'm sorry, but it was
totally makes
Cal
sense
State
today
schools.
In today's world, anything in California could be named Dirtbag, but that's funny.
Right. So he had played baseball out there and was pretty good from all the accounts we heard. And, the name on the somebody found a picture of him playing baseball, and on the jersey it says Bags, and which was short for Dirt Bags. I'm like, that's fantastic. I'm a baseball guy, so I'm like, I didn't know that was their name. So he got that from his baseball days. So he was Dirt Bag. We just rode him unmercifully. So the crowning achievement of his career, according to him, his words, not mine, was to get control, get command of the 336th Fighter Squadron, the Rocketeers, which was the first F-15E squadron.
Wow.
And he celebrated by running out to the local Ford dealership and buying a canary yellow, because yellow is the Rocketeers'
color.
Tail flash color. There's always a stripe on the tail, and ours was yellow. And so he ran out and celebrated and bought a Mustang GT, and came driving back on base with that thing, squealed into the parking lot. He goes, look what I got. And we all come out and we're like, oh man, the boss bought the new Mustang. And it was yellow. I mean, as yellow as it could possibly be. One of the guys comes out of the bar at that point and he goes, hey boss, I need a ride. You're a taxi, right? And So every time anyone in the squadron saw him, they like stick their thumb out, hey, taxi. And
he
sold the thing after like 6 months because he was so mad at everybody.
I bet he did. You deflated that balloon so fast.
We ruined it for
him. Oh my God. That is so funny.
We were so bad.
That is so funny.
Yeah, one of the best guys I knew in the Air Force, just as fair and as honest as you could possibly be. Super guy.
Well, that's awesome. Now I'm gonna not finish now, but I'm saying I want to come back to the leadership lessons component of what we talked about, mm-hmm. and kind of finish on that, so I can kind of tie some things in. But and I want you to be comfortable here. I told you this before the conversation, but when I tell people that an F-15E pilot's coming on with 650 hours of combat experience, flying in Gulf War I, Gulf War II, Iraq, Afghanistan, they all want to hear, you know, some of the, and I say glory because I'm a patriot and America is winning, right? I don't want to offend anybody with that because war is an ugly thing. But as my dad used to say, avoid getting in a fight, but if you do, win. Cheat, bite, mm-hmm. kick, doesn't matter.
Yep.
You finish the thing. So some people would, I'm sure, and me too, this is my geeky point here. Some of the combat stories. Now you told me one funny one about the Saddam bomb, and yeah. I did want to hear that. And then you would give me a couple of notes here, and I just want you to kind of go through those stories and share them if you would.
Yeah. So the Saddam bomb was, you know, again, I'm a big nerd, so this one appealed to me on a lot of levels. During Gulf War I and also Gulf War II, there was this huge search for Saddam because the guy had bunkers and tunnels
everywhere.
And
oh yeah,
spider everywhere. I mean, all over the country, and there were probably some in other countries too. So this cat was difficult to find. And so, you know, the guys, the Delta Force guys, the CIA guys, were constantly trying to find him. They had, you know, informants looking for him. Hey, we saw him at the falafel shop down the street. You know. And
yep.
2 minutes later, the falafel shop, you know,
disappears.
500 pound. Yeah, so, it's hard to find. I mean, the guy was pretty well prepared for all this. But the Saddam bomb was, I believe it's the GBU-24.
Mm-hmm.
And that was
monster big.
A genius monster design by the guys at the Eglin Air Warfare Center. So they come up with interesting things that go boom. And in this case, they needed something that could penetrate these French-built bunkers that he had all over the place. You know, think the Maverick movie. You've got a thing underground that's covered by rock and concrete and all this stuff. And, you know, a 2,000 pound bomb usually will go through most stuff like a knife going through butter. But in this case, there were some pretty hardened shelters. So enter the guys at the warfare center, came, got to work, and they said, what's the hardest steel casing we've got? And some guy comes back in with a 105 howitzer barrel, you know, literally the barrel of a
big gun
that shoots these huge projectiles the Army's using. And it's enormously well made. It's you can't hurt the metal. I mean, if you shot projectiles through it all the time, it just comes back for more. So like, this is the hardest thing that we know of. And so they cut it to the length they wanted, and they filled the barrel with this crazy explosive called Octol, which is just unbelievably explosive. Put a seeker head on just a typical laser guided seeker head and some fins on the back. And you had a 4,800 pound bomb,
a bunker buster,
the bunker buster. That's exactly what we called it. And so they tested this thing. I thought this was fabulous. We saw some video of this. So in Eglin, they have this rocket sled where they put things on it to simulate terminal velocity. And they shoot it down this track and they put steel plates or concrete blocks to simulate it going through whatever it's going to go through. So they had something like 200 feet of reinforced concrete at the end of this sled. And so they put just, you know, an inner Saddam bomb on this, speed it up on the sled. It goes through the 200 feet of concrete without slowing down and goes out the other side and keeps on going. So we're like, what is that thing? That is awesome. And about 2 weeks later, you know, fully armed and fueled Saddam bomb showed up in these crates at our base, because the only thing that could carry it was the F-15E. And so they came to us, and no joke, you know, the E model is a fully loaded, it's about 80,000 pounds. So when you hang a 5,000 pound bomb on it, you know, if you hung it on the center line, it probably wouldn't deflect the struts on the landing gear much. But if you hang it on the wings where we were
a lot of counterbalance
things,
needed. Yeah.
There was a lot of counterbalance, and you know, so much in fact that they had to sort of tweak the flight control computer to fly, and like the computer's like, why do I have all this weight?
Why do I lean left? Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So usually had to carry two of them just to make it
unbelievable.
So, yeah, that was a Saddam bomb. It was that was just the biggest nerd success story ever. And
so is that just a timing fuse then? It's just a 15 millisecond.
It has a proximity fuse where it knows how far and fast it's traveling. And then when it stops running into resistance,
it goes,
I think it's inside the room, it goes. And it's impressive. I mean, that thing goes through rock and concrete. Like it's not even there. It's amazing.
Unbelievable. Well,
those guys,
the Moab, you know, they dropped two when they were trying to get bin Laden, the Moab, mother of all bombs. And
those fuel air explosives are fascinating to watch. I mean, it's the most powerful thing short of a nuclear bomb. And it sucks. It's basically just a big canister of that octol stuff I was telling you about.
Yep.
And it has an atomizer, and then there's this fuse that floats down into this cloud of explosive and ignites it, and it just atomizes all the air and just sucks all the air. So whatever's in the cave that it blows up next to gets sucked out the front of the cave, which is pretty amazing to watch.
No kidding. So combat, combat stories, what do you got there? So, I mean, I you're flying at night, I don't know how many sorties you flew in GW1, Gulf War One, but I know we flew over 100,000, I think, preparing for the ground war there.
It was gratifying on a lot of levels because we could see all the guys in the tanks, our guys in the tanks, just waiting.
Right.
We were trying to attrit all the tanks that were there, and it would all wave because they knew what we were doing. So we felt like we were fighting for the army there for a while. So they got cranked up, and then they just kicked ass in their tanks, because that thing's an amazing thing. That's my other bucket list item, is to ride in an Abrams tank someday, because I'm like, man, that's the coolest thing ever. But yeah, so one of the fun stories I was always amazed at and enjoyed telling was, as everyone remembers that was alive and watching the news during the Gulf War, was the terror missile that Saddam had, the Scuds that were on mobile launchers. Now these things they're kind of like World War II V2 and B1. They're terror weapons. They didn't, the
no
worry
accuracy.
Was they could load them up. Yeah. They were worried that they could carry chemical weapons with them. So very quickly when it became clear that there weren't going to be much, no one was going to come up to fly against the F-16s and the F-15s and the A-18s from the Navy. So the air war kind of ground down to looking for Scuds out in the desert. And a lot of these things were hid way up in the northwestern desert of Iraq, and it's just nothing up there. So the E models were, and along with a lot of other folks too, were tasked with going into what they call a kill box. There's a, 10 by 10 mile or 100 mile square box of airspace. And the AWACS would look for, a launch, or there's some guys on the ground. A lot of the commandos were running around on the ground trying to find these things, and they would call in and say, hey, there's one here, come get it. So one night there was one of those situations where a couple of E models were up over a remote kill box. And a call came through the AWACS from a British commando team. And these guys, as calm as you could possibly be, were just like, yeah, there's two Iraqi Hind helicopters disgorging about a company-sized group of fighters on our position. So they've been found in the middle of the desert, and that's really no good place to hide.
Yeah.
So the guy's like, if you have anyone in the area, could you maybe vector them our way? If not, we'll handle it. Wow, these guys are badass.
No doubt.
And the Brits were in every sense of the word.
Yeah.
So there were two Strike Eagles in that box. And so they got there. And so when they the Strike Eagles see the helicopters. They were actually hovering right over the ground, letting all these guys out. And so trying to look down and shoot down a helicopter that's sitting still on the ground is a difficult thing for an air-to-air missile. So genius guy, Ken Backey, in the front seat of one of the E-models goes, hey, it's just sitting there. Why don't we hit it with a bomb? And there was silence, and they're like, huh, I never thought to do that. So he lasers the helicopter, puts the laser right on the windshield of the first helicopter, and unloads a 2,000-pound laser-guided bomb onto the helicopter. And it's like hitting a gnat with a sledgehammer. I mean, it just flattened it and, you know, got the other one the same way. And so the Brits called back up, thanks, that was impressive, enjoyed the show. And they signed off and whatever. Yep. So like 3-4 days later, these guys come walking out of the desert into the Rocketeer's bar at the base, and they go, hey, we're looking for the 336 guys that were over box whatever,
you know, that's three, me, 4 nights ago. Yeah, right here.
They're like, we brought you something. We're like, what are you talking about? And they're like, well, this is the biggest piece we could find of the helicopter. And it was like, you know, like a foot and a half by a foot and a half piece of just molten helicopter aviation aluminum.
That's awesome.
And so it is still hanging in the Rocketeer's bar back in Goldsboro, North Carolina. And there's a picture on it with all the guys from the Brits commando team and they
presenting
were
it.
And, that's yeah, awesome. So that was fun. So yeah, that was the first air-to-air kill of a helicopter with a bomb. And I don't think anybody's done that. I'm not sure anyone would think to do that, except Tim was a genius. He's like, oh yeah, we could hit it with a bomb because it's not moving.
That's hysterical. Like, right. That's hysterical.
That's genius. So yeah, I mean, you know, that one was an interesting way to employ, you know, just a different way of thinking. All right, it's not going to work that way. Let's do this.
Yeah, forget the traditional. Set the manual down. Yeah. Let's solve the problem, as you said
win
earlier.
The fight, however you can win the fight.
Yeah. So. Now you talked about tank plinking. I mean, that had to be.
Yeah.
There were a lot of targets.
And you know, that was the job, was because, you know, we could see how many tanks our guys had lined up versus all the ones the Iraqis were. I don't think they were dumb. They just didn't know what else to do.
Yep.
Because, you know, we could fly at night. We could look down with the forward-looking infrared and the radar, and just, you know, against the desert background,
they
a
stand
tank,
out. Yeah.
It's just plain as day. So, you know, and it's just sitting there in its little revetment that they've dug for it, and you put a 500-pound laser-guided bomb right in the turret, and it got to the very, very quickly. The word got out among Iraqi tankers that, like, we can't sleep in the tanks. We'll get blasted from above. So, you know, they're setting up little tents next to the tanks because they knew at some point death from above was going to arise. So
yep.
that was combined forces winning the battle there, because, you know, we know the more tanks we wipe out, that's less that the Army has to
wipe up. Yep, yep.
So, yeah, it was a good – and, you know, we talked to those guys on a pretty regular basis about, you know, where are the weak points. Not that a 500-pound bomb from 8,000 feet has a whole lot of work to do, but, you know, they were like, look, you know, if you're going to destroy this kind of tank, you know, put the bomb here. This is the weakest part of the armor. So it was, you know, the cross-pollination of knowledge got really, really big starting in those days. And it's, you know, it's stuff we do as just a matter of course now.
Yep.
And the young guys that are doing it now, that's just the way they've grown up doing it, which is great. I mean, that you hear about the joint tours where, you know, an Air Force guy gets embedded with an Army group or something like that. And you learn what those guys need, and then you take it back to your squadron and say, okay, when we're doing this, they want that. And it really is a gratifying thing to see the knowledge base get bigger.
Yep. Now, did you ever have any air-to-air? Now, I'm doing a little look on this. Only two 15s were lost in that endeavor, both to missiles, not to any air-to-air combat. Did you have any? Because they really started hiding these things. They were flying their jets out. The Iraqi Air Force went and hid in a lot of places. Did you had said that was over quickly. Did you encounter any resistance air-to-air while you were there or not?
Well, the Iraqi Air Force was just not up to the task.
Yeah.
You know, at that time, the F-15C was king of the skies. And so, you know, those guys shot down many MiGs that came with the first two, 3 days. the MiG-29 just really took a beating. That was supposed to be their frontline jet, and the C models just really beat them down.
Yep.
So the E models were tasked with, you know, deep interdiction strikes. So much like the F-117s, yep. So the downtown targets, I'm using downtown in air quotes. The 117s got the ones where they were just going to be completely bracketed by any aircraft batteries.
You remember and seeing the nighttime, the nighttime in Baghdad, exactly, yeah. Shooting just everywhere because they're already gone. Yeah, right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, those guys were already past the targets, and they started shooting when the bombs went off, which, you know, the 117's 5 miles away at that point. The E models were doing the same thing. And a lot of the 18 guys, the 2C18 guys from the carriers were trying to do the same kind of thing. So it was high value targets, you know, the infrastructure, the surface air missile batteries and their command
communication,
and
command
kind of
control.
Thing.
Right.
Yeah,
right. Right.
Exactly. So those were the high value targets that, and we ran out of those pretty quick as, you know, we didn't have to restrike a lot of them because, you know, the first strikes
were
so
accurate.
And that's great because that's what you want is to keep the guys from getting shot at routinely as a matter of, oh, we got to go back and hit that bridge again. Oh, the bridge is gone. It's at the bottom of the Tigris River. So
right.
It's good to see. Yeah. That kind of effectiveness is pretty gratifying to watch. And, you know, the first night I remember we had a little CNN embedded camera crew with us and, it came out much later, but you know, the first night, the guys flying those missions like that for the downtown missions, they were thinking that the Air Force planners were that, you know, 30 to 40% of the pilots and jets wouldn't come back. They didn't share that with anybody, but they're trying to figure out, all right, how do we get through the first week here if we're losing all these guys to anti-aircraft fire? Well, the first night everybody came back, one Navy guy got shot down. And he saw him on POW video for a while, but he got caught the first night. And another guy from our wing, he was Don Everly, and he got shot down with his backseater. They were POWs too. They came back. They were fine. But yeah, so but those were the only casualties that first night. I think there was an A. I can't remember what kind of jet it was. There was one Navy guy that did not come back. His last name was Spiker. Gotcha. I think he was in an 18, and he did not make it back. But I think Chuck Horner, all the guys in the planning group were amazed at how survivable all the jets had become. And that was also gratifying personally to see.
Oh gosh, yeah. That, especially when you're getting ready to strap in and working. Take your turn. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, yeah. I mean, that was all the stuff that kept us from getting just blasted was a lot of those black boxes we mentioned previously. So mm-hmm. those things did some very interesting electronic things and made the jet survivable. So that was, you know, it's fine in a simulator, but until you actually go up against a really complex integrated air defense system like the Iraqis had built, you're never quite sure. You're like, okay, let's see how that, let's flip the switch and
what
turn
are we
it
doing?
On and see what it does.
What are we doing?
But I mean, thank God for electrical engineers.
Interesting story on survivability of planes. And this goes back to the Vietnam era. And I don't remember where I read and saw this, and then I looked further into it, but they were trying to figure out how to build a more survivable aircraft, right? Because of ground fire and air to air combat. And they were looking at planes that came back that were full of holes and studying where the holes were.
Where do you armor it?
Where do you armor it? And they weren't improving the survivability rate. And then somebody has this, you know, everybody in the room was being dumb and didn't realize it. And they said, we need to put more armor where the planes coming back don't have holes because they're coming back where the holes are.
That isn't
critical. Where are there not holes? That's evidently what's taken out the plane. And it was like, holy cow, you just kind of have to take a step back to think. And and that's when our survivability and then, you know, fighter training and things like that started happening. And you know, Maverick was born. In the movies, but interesting stuff. So just from the bottom of my heart, my family's heart and everybody listening, I know, thank you so much for your service. It's a joy and a privilege to, you know, to be able to, to work with you during the day, but also to hear these great stories and sharing them. What kind of, because the bravery is just, it's unbelievable to be willing to sacrifice yourself. What leadership lessons did you bring back? Was there somebody that was really impactful to you that you saw through all that military training and those experiences over 15 odd years?
I'm glad you asked. And it's, I have been enormously blessed. And I think a lot of the guys that I served with would say the same thing. We always felt like we had been prepared as well as we could have possibly been. And that, I guess that's the whole goal. You hear a lot of the guys that go through Top Gun or Red Flag in the Air Force, mm-hmm. or the Fort Irwin Training Center for the Army guys. They say that the simulations, the war games are tougher than the actual thing. And in a lot of cases, that's true. I hope we continue to work that hard at training and, if I have to lay down in front of a bulldozer, yeah, I will, because that's what saves a lot of lives. But yeah, I mean, there were a ton of guys. I think I mentioned General Olds, who was an F-4 pilot. And this guy, he's the fighter pilot, and he flew in World War II, flew P-51s, flew Mustangs. In Korea.
Yeah.
And he flew, I think, F-4s in Vietnam for a lot of years. And
wow.
Rose, he was a wing commander during his time in Vietnam. And he wrote a book along with his daughter not long before he passed several years ago. And, you know, he lived by these things. He decided to write them down. And, you know, I'll paraphrase it just because, you know, he could say it better than I can. But if you ever want to read Fighter Pilot, the memoirs of legendary ace Robin Olds, I've got it right here on my desk. I highly recommend it. He always said that the best leaders, and in his favorite was Jimmy Doolittle from World War II. I think everyone knows Doolittle is just
Doolittle raids. Yeah.
They connected with their troops on a very personal level. You know, there was still the leadership was, and the chain of command was intact, but you knew that those guys had your back.
Yep.
They were there trying to get stuff out of the way so you could do your job. That always resonated really, really heavily with me. Another thing he always said was get to know your people. You know, what do they expect? What's their attitude? You have to know what everyone in the organization is thinking and feeling, so you can motivate appropriately. He always was a big, big proponent of meeting the guys in all the sections, not just hanging with the fighter pilots, but, you know, he went down, he talked to the avionics guys, he talked to the mechanics, he talked mm-hmm. to the guys working on stuff.
Everybody.
He knew what they were up against, and he was the squadron and the wing commander. So it was his job to make sure that the whole unit worked, not just the pilots. And sometimes I think, you know, back in the day, that was one of the gripes against some of the bosses was that, you know, the pilots hung with the pilots and
yeah,
you know,
they
you
got
don't see
siloed.
That so much anymore.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah. And the great leaders, they'll get down on the flight line and they'll turn a wrench and they'll pull a dash 60 around and hook it up to a jet. Those guys are the ones that you had a war with. And you're like, I'll go through a wall. For that
That's
guy.
Right.
And so I always paraphrase and say, you lead from the front. You do whatever you need to do to show your guys and fellow service members that you're going to do whatever you need to do, just like they will. And you're not too proud to do, you know, quote unquote, menial job. You know, and he lived that for a lot of years in three different armed conflicts.
Man.
He's just the guy that, you know, I'm like, okay, that's my North Star. That's who I want to be like.
That's awesome.
And he was a hell of a fighter pilot too. And
I bet he was.
He was as good as he was at flying the jet. He was better at leading men. So I have just mountains of respect for him.
You know, it's the lot of key components there. There's tons of great stuff. First of all, to come out alive, flying in World War II. Korea and then of course Vietnam, and you know, in two of those conflicts they had bridles on our stallions. They didn't mm-hmm. let us do what we needed to do to really take care of business, but goes back to, if you're going to get in, you win. Politics comes into things too much, but that, be willing to do anything. Don't ask anybody to do you wouldn't do yourself, you know. I mean, you can
right.
just tell that this guy was an absolute stud leader, and I'm really, really glad you shared that, because those are attributes we all can use every single day.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I always try to, and I am not comparing myself to Brigadier General Olds with any of these statements. I do not deserve to even be considered that way. But I think that showing vulnerability and understanding, I say a lot of times, I'm just Brent. I carry different responsibilities than others on the team, but I'm just Brent, right? I mean, what do you need help with? How can I support you here? What can I get out of your way? That was another important thing that I think you said is empower your people to do their job, get stuff out of their way. Mm-hmm. Don't allow people that aren't actually delivering the results to do more than what they're there to do, because you got to let the war fighting be done by the war fighters. That was our problem in Vietnam, right? Is all decisions to get involved, to engage or not, was being led by the Pentagon, you know, 15,000 miles away, 12,000 miles away, instead of giving field commanders and air commanders the ability to say, take it out now. The target's gone by the time it gets the Pentagon and back, right? That cost thousands and thousands of lives. And we learned our lesson there. And the next time we really had to unleash the lions, President Bush Sr. Did a great job. And if he'd have gone all the way to Baghdad, he'd have won in 92. Now, not saying that's good or bad. I think that in the next 9 months, how the country turned on him was amazing. It just shows how fickle of a country we are, and we forget so quickly. He was a hero, too, led the CIA fighter pilot, shot down, at Chichagina.
Torpedo bomber.
Yeah, torpedo bomber, and was shot down and rescued by a submarine in between Iwo Jima and Chichagina. My military history major, as you can tell, remembers all this stuff. But great book called The Flyboys. There's a couple books called that, but it touches on him a little bit, and then how our torpedo bombers, Coral Sea and Midway, they were all taken to Chichagina, which was the radio station island over all those islands around Iwo Jima and all those different types of things. And they did terrible things to our boys that were captured. But leadership starts from the heart, and you have to show on a day in and day out basis. And Russel, I just really, really appreciate you sharing this, your story. You do an absolutely fantastic job supporting my needs every single day in your day job. But God bless you, man. I owe you a lot. America owes you a lot. Your friends, I'm sure some of them didn't come back, lost in training, lost in fighting, etc. And we need to remember true heroes like yourself. So thanks for coming on. Is any final words of wisdom that you want to share, or anything else that we haven't gotten to before I let you go?
We covered a lot. No, I think we
touched them all.
Covered it all. I enjoyed that. That was, thanks for the opportunity to talk. It's always fun to talk airplanes, and I'll do that at the drop of a hat.
Well, and we will do more of this when we're not on the recording devices too. I can't wait to hear some more stories that aren't suitable for podcasts while I'm still employed in a publicly traded organization.
I've got a couple of those I could share.
Yeah, I can't wait. But hey, to all the listeners out there, thank those around you that give to others and that have served this great country. And most importantly, I know you're awesome. Keep that shit up. Talk next week.